Well, I start with them, or do you want to talk?
Let's start doing a little something. You know, which one of you guys does not play drums at all? Okay, you're the guy I knew. You're singing, right?
Yeah.
You don't have a ring on your hands or anything, huh? Okay, good. Because, you know, we can't play with a ring. The mentality in the United States, and I don't mean this as an offense, is that this instrument, it's a soul thing. You just go buy them, do them any way you want to, and then just try to play anything, really. Okay, and that's one example. If somebody would, and this percussionist, they play like that, you know? And at least it was on time doing that, you know? And they give gigs. And then when somebody comes around that really knows how to play, they go like, well, I had this. Well, you play the Spanish way and I play the American way. I said, I don't play Spanish, I'm playing Cuban, you know? And it's like that. Cuban drums are 100% structuralist, including the solos. The solos, you have to learn that vocabulary, and then you mix this phrase with this phrase. We call them phrases, you know, like a simple, tu 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 ta tu ta. You know, then I can modify it, I can go, you know, and you have to do them on the beat, you know, and everything is like,
for a moment I thought he really knows how to play.
I want to get your car,
But it's like that, they buy the instrument, you know, and they, you know, this drum here, unless you're playing songo, you know, or a one-one call, then you live with this drum, but when you're not playing those rhythms, this drum, simple in four, is playing on the and three. Or you can hit it on the and. So you're going one, two, and three, you know? So you're going like this. Simple four rhythm. And three, that's on the and three. That's on the and. I can do what I'm doing here, four and. I can do it like this, four and. And the tapao is on two. See? And then when you start like this. Now the timbala player, if he's doing this, and let's say it's a double time rhythm, and the arrangement is like this, you know, whatever rhythm you like, style, when you hit, when I, the timbala player, when he hear, you have to go in like that. That's what I want you. Yeah, go ahead.
That was the Wawanka that you just did? Or?
No, actually, no. Wawanko, if it is orchestrated, for example, on the Wawanko, if you have an orchestra or a conjunto, we call them conjuntos, you know, you all know anything below 12 is not an orchestra. The woman call would be playing the tumbadora parts if there is a bass player. So he would be doing tum, 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 on clave. Tum, 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 tum. Then the tumbadora player, he's going to be playing against the clave. Because the rule of Cuban music is you're going to be on clave. But then when they play the woman call, they want to do some strange syncopation. And instead of doing it, you can do it like this, by the way.
Yeah.
You might run into some narrow-minded musician, I'm going to tell you, hey, little man, you got to go against the clave. No, it's correct, because I've had before Katrina a collection of Cuban music from the 40s, even the 30s, and I heard great group players, you know, playing on clave. On clave would be like this. And that's correct, you can do it like that, but a lot of the guys, they like to do it like this. Against the clave, so either way you do it, it's correct. Mm-hmm. You can do it on clave, and that's why this guy from the Dominican Republic told me, hey man, I'm confused, the Cubans always say, be on the clave, be on the clave, and then I hear the woman call, and it's going against the clave. I said, well, that is another style. It depends on what province in Cuba you go to. And this instrument is not called congas, or congas, okay? That is like calling a Chevrolet a Ford, you know, or a Ferrari, a Porsche, you know, whatever. They're all tumbadoras, but when you're talking slang, they call the bass drum tumbador, which is what they call the person that plays the instrument. Now, you can say tumbadorista, which is like trumpetist. And the tenor tumbadora is called tres dos. But in Matanzas, some people call it cachimbo, you know. And then the alto tumbadora, they call it the quinto. It's as simple as that. Anybody wants to play the little something?
Yeah. Y'all want to play a tune?
Oh, is there any other tumbadoras over here, Ricky?
Yeah.
Ricky, I need a symbol on the stand, man.
Right there.
Yeah, I forgot my
my symbol on my stand in the case. I can't do it.
I'm just kind of scared.
Oh, I thought you was trying to put me on the drum.
Let me go get my bass real quick.
That way I can counter myself.
That's the most like he told me how to hit that. Yeah.
I met a Cuban historian. I was fortunate. I used to come to the neighborhood and talk about the Cuban drums, and I learned a lot from those guys that I'm not around today. But I was a kid in Havana, and I was like 11 years old and 12. And
oh, I know.
In Cuba, the old folks.
I'm sorry, I couldn't go to
that. And the young children would get together. There's a lot of respect or camaraderie, and they would come and talk. And then I learned from these two Cuban historians that the guy who invented the timbale was left-handed.
Yeah.
And that's why people got confused. And then timbales, I would say 50% or 60% of the Cubans, they play left-handed, and they get impaired because they can put this drum on the left side. So if you want to do this, you have to go, you know, like that, left-handed, and it impairs you. If you want to do this, you know, and then they use the symbol on the right side. But then some of the Cubans, whether they knew it or not, they say, wait a minute, man. The principle is that all the Cuban drums always have the bass drum on the right side, like the bongos, the tumbadoras. I like to put the bass tumbadora on my left. And then my tenor, well, this one is about the same size as this one, but maybe I can go a little bit more.
That one's got a wrench on it too, if you want to tune anything.
Yeah, I wonder if that's the same size. I got my wrench right there in that box. That's the box I use for my gigs, you know, it's just tips. Mandolins and my cowbells. We don't call this cowbells in Cuba. A cowbell in Cuba, or it would be called cencerro. And a cencerro has a rattler, and it's made of copper, and it sounds terrible, you can't play with that. This is the bass bell, campana, means bell, that the bongo player uses on the bridge. Now, traditionally, in Cuba, back in the days, you know, the timbale player always played the cascara, and then on the cha-cha-cha, he would play quarter notes of the small bell. Everything on the cha-cha-cha part. When there was a bolero part, then you would play down here. And on the bridge, the bongo player played the bell. So together, it sounded more or less like this. Whatever style he was playing, you know, you would hear that. And but then later on, they started playing with more bells, so that the timbale player was playing a pattern like this. And with the left hand, what you do if you are right-handed, you just play time. And the accent simple is on four. Same as on the tumbadoras, you can feel the music on four. Every time you hear that, that's four and. And this is on two, you know? But you can add more than one tap out. The bongos, the bass drum goes also on the four, on the timbale. For timing, you also accent the four, you know? That's why, you know, when you see the timbales player, you can do it like this. If you're playing the other way, you know, you can do it like this. More like this. Trying to get that sound. But you only do one and it's very soft. You don't want it to be heard, you want it to be felt. It's just for timing because the tumbador is playing that part. You know, you don't want to be playing like this, you know. Yeah, it's going to clash with that. It's like if I was playing the right cymbal bar on the tumbador. Imagine me going ding 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 on the tumbador. You know? I've done gigs with some trap drummers that don't know how to play with other percussionists, and they started playing my part. One of my parts here like this. And I told the police, "Don't do that." I said, "That's what I'm doing." You know. Well, let's do something. You know?
Yeah.
I'm giving you an idea of how everything is. So I'm the guy who writes a new chapter all the time. So I knew that the timbales have been played 50 or 60% wrong because most of the guys they're right-handed and they're playing with this thing on the left side, so they have to go kupra 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 pra pra rukutu kupra, you know, and that impairs you. Imagine if you have to do something like this. Have to go. But I had a lot of arguments with guys who played traditionally, and then I said, "Well, let's see, let's do things together." And then they dropped the sticks. They couldn't do stuff like that. You know? Imagine on the beat, you know, if you're doing something on the rhythm like this, what am I gonna do on the tumbadoras? And you have to play something like this. Ricky, you want to give me a little hand?
What you need?
On the timbales, just play a little. Let's say, play the one go. Okay. Cascara, but on the pedal, and try to catch it like this at an angle.
All right.
Yeah. That's the time. A one, a two, a one, two, three, four. I am ambidextrous, but I stopped writing with the left hand, which I gave it up because I said I don't really need it. It takes a lifetime just to learn how to write, and then you have to learn how to use a spoon the other way or a knife, whatever. Everything has to be learned one by one, and you can only master a few. I mastered to fight like this, you know, the strong side forward, and it gives me an edge because I have the strong fight, and then I used to bat. And I was terrible at baseball because I was always afraid of the ball, you know. And I got hit a few times and I said,
that's not good.
But when it came to this, no, I wasn't afraid. And but I learned I could bat, and guys used to get confused. Well, look at this guy. And then I could throw with the left hand too. But it's not the same accuracy, the same precision, you know. I like with the right way, you know, the way I was born, I could hit the target. And with the other way, I would miss it. Few more times, you know, so it's like that. Well, you know, I don't have them quite tuned, but that's right for right now. You notice how I was keeping time with him, and he was locking with me. That's how you play Cuban music. You have to lock time perfectly. On the montunos, the piano might seem like it's ahead of the beat, you know, because of the way the rhythm. Then the bass player, he's kind of like anchoring a little bit. Because the piano player is going to be doing, you know, stuff like that. It sounds, you know, it sounds to you like he's rushing, but he's not.
I call it stretching time.
Yeah, you know, Cuban music. Yeah, Cuban music is it's you know, you have to learn how to relax it in order to maintain that thing. And then the Cubans developed a technique that they would suddenly speed it up deliberately, and then they would bring it gradually, slowly to the original tempo. That's hard to do. We've been doing it together for over 30 years.
Oh, really?
When I do a bongo drum solo and I'm playing, I'm doing more than polyrhythms, by the way, you know. But I'm playing the vocabulary, you know. James and, hey, is that you? I didn't recognize you, man. It took me a while to recognize you. James and Steve, when I'm doing the solo, you know, a lot of the phrases, they, you know, they seem to be rushed, and sometimes they will step out of ahead of the beat a little bit, and then when I finish the solo, I start bringing it down slowly, and we are so tight together, you know, that only us three can do that the way we do it, you know. Yeah, that's one of my guys that play with me, Otto Gicks, you know. And this guy and I, we played together a few gigs. With piano, and Ricky Zibaster. That's his nickname.
Oh, yeah, right.
I won't tell you my name for him.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Actually, it was an honor. It was not for make fun of anybody. In the 70s, all the musicians in the city that had a nickname, that meant that we were the elite. Once you had a nickname, you were, oh wow, thank you, Hector. Thank you, Steve. You know, thank you, Ricky, for giving me a nickname. James Black, he came to me and said, Hector. You know, how come you haven't given me a nickname?
X-ray one is called, I said, Massachusetts.
You want a nickname for me? Well, no, I want it from you, you know? So I gave him a nickname, and he said, yeah, that's what the brothers call me on the street, but I was just joking with him. And he took it seriously, and then I couldn't find him, and he comes back like a week later, and he said, Hector, no, give me another nickname. That one won't do. I said, man, I was just driving with you. How about this one? I can't say it because we got a lady here. And he said, yeah, I love that last name. I mean, that nickname. Steve has a nickname.
Right, yeah. Massachusetts, that's the good one.
Yeah, that I cleaned it up as Massachusetts. Yeah. And James Singles. And I didn't have a nickname for Lady BJ.
Oh, no.
And then Jason Patterson, I won't say it. He says, oh, I see the lady. I said, no, man, are you crazy? You know, that would be an insult. And we got to find, I can't remember. Then Jermaine
Benson. Oh, yeah, right. Okay. Let's get back on. So look, tell us again the differences between, what's the difference between a bolero and a cha-cha-cha and a song? Well, we are just tell. How many different categories of Cuban music are there, or, you know, rhythms?
You know, last time I checked, and this is way a few decades ago, it was close to 400.
400?
Well, yeah,
rhythms.
Yeah, and you tend to forget them, you know. Like, I'm trying to remember which is the right one for the guaracha. Guaracha was a style of song in the 50s that was very popular, and the pattern they play on the what we call the cascara, which means the feel of the timbales. I lost everything to Katrina, so I got to get me a collection to get from the 50s to be able. As soon as I hear it, I will transcribe it right away. But a lot of nowadays, most people, they play the one called cascara, which fits, you know, and or everything is fused, except salsa. Salsa is so mediocre that they always use the same fusion. It's still Cuban music. They're just fusing guaguancó with mambo and song and some montuno, which means some montuno is a Cuban country folks, you know. And all that music is for dancing. Now, if you guys wanted to search on the internet, look up for Cuban music called contradanza and then song, and then you're gonna find complex. I'm talking about very complex harmony and a lot of changes. I found stuff that has more changes than jazz on a dance song. one dance song that was sampled that had 14 chord changes. Have you ever listened to dance song music?
Mm-hmm.
Ricky listens to a lot of stuff. That's good.
No, but what are the five most common names that people use to describe, like different tempos or different beats?
Yeah,
like here in America, what would you say are the most popular styles from Cuba that ended up in America over the decades?
It was song music, and they used to call it rumbas, and misinterpretation, you know. Song music is what you know today as salsa, but back in the days, you know, the styles were different. But they used to call them rumba bands, and they're in reality. They would play a rumba too, because a Cuban orchestra, you know, they'll have to play everything.
So what does a rumba sound like, if you had to play a rumba?
Okay, a rumba would, for example, the Wamongo that is so popular. Simple with two would be like this, and it's actually two guys playing this pattern here. One guy's playing like this. That's one style, depending on the province you come from. Another style is like this. Or then the other guy is playing the counter, and he's doing it like this. Simple. And I was using four or five, then I would do it like this. Like that, you know. That's one cool. Then there's the Columbia rumba, which is very, very fast, and you have to be cardiovascular, very fit to dance to that. And the tumbalero part, which is the bass drum, The bass tumbala is playing this pattern. Listen to this. I'm gonna do it slow so you get the idea. And that's on the clave. Tack, 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 tack. Then the contrary to this. Several bars like that, you know, with the and three on the higher pitch tumbalero drum. The guy playing against that is doing this. Slow either, you know. Then the wamongo usually at the end when it's fading out, then they speed it up a little bit, and then it fades.
So a wamongo and a rumba are the same thing?
It's a rumba, yes. And then the very slow rumba that they play, it's called the jambu. And sometimes they do the jambu very similar, I mean, like a wawanko, but very slow. And it's meant more for a relaxed way of singing. Is there a bass player among you guys?
Yeah.
Oh, then you are the bass player.
Yeah.
Okay, one example. On the cha-cha-cha. Have you ever played a cha-cha-cha?
I don't know.
No.
Okay. I have conductor's ear, so I'm the guy here in the city who teaches everybody. Yeah, how you doing over there, man? How to play the I'm not a bass player, but I teach the guys, you know, James Singleton, Steve Son, Martin, Josh, Rappel, yeah. You know, so they can go and all the basics. On the woman call on the beat, the bass is doing it. On the cha-cha-cha. Ding ding dong, ding dong, 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 ding ding dong. That's the main pattern, right? And you know how to play the cha-cha-cha. The piano player is going to be going. And I will be playing like this. Ricky, you want to play some portos here?
Sure.
It's supposed to be on the little bell, and it's supposed to be pianissimo. You know, we all know what pianissimo means, right? But now people don't know terminology, you know? I said to this guy, no, do a mordente, and he said, you know what a mordente is, right?
He said, how much have dentists already this week?
Ricky, you know what a mordente is? Steve, you know what a mordente is?
I forgot.
In percussion, a mordente would be this.
If I
don't say flam, then I'm gonna.
Yeah.
But that's what I used to use all the Italian terminology because all the terminology in music is Italian. So go ahead, do that. Yes. Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, boom. You come in on the drum pedal, and from there, you can wait. Let me see. Boom. Ding ding dong ding dong. And at the same playing when I'm hitting forehand. That's what you're gonna be doing. Ding ding dong ding dong. And then when you switch, you're gonna switch to 3-4 and 3-4. 3-4 and 3-4 and so in other words you're gonna be doing this. You don't have to do the rest, you're just gonna be doing. Switch. There's a whole lot of them, but let's start with those two, you know?
Over there, here.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4. Started calling later on, years later, Afro Bolero, but it's not called Afro Bolero. It's called Bolero Moruno, M-O-R-U-N-O. And it's still a bolero, but and then the guy on the bell is playing similar. He's doing yeah, I can do that too. And then the bass is playing. Let's try that. Sometimes you start on the three, you go one, two, and then you end on the one. Let's try that. But I come in on the one and you guys come in on the one. Let's do a cha-cha-cha again. But Ricky's gonna start on the three. One, two, okay. One, two, three.
Notes die out, so it sounds more like
you
a drum.
You have to adjust it. Does anybody have any tune that you would like to do as a cha-cha-cha? You know, you can do any tune, and when you play Cuban jazz, you can play any song on a clear day, whatever song. But
we can do a Mambo Influenciado as a cha-cha.
This
way. Should we move a little closer to the room, or?
Okay,
you know, by the time the ear reaches the sound, it sounds like
a yeah. I know you like it.
All in my face.
You can have it.
You! Stop doing this. Just after these two.
See that I'm doing the same phrase over and over because Cuban drums, everything is 100% structurized. And then later on, you mix this phrase with this phrase and, you know, you suit it to your style, you know? Okay, so one.
He goes one, two. On the two, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
One, two,
dun,
dun, dun, dun, dun, dun, two, three.
You're gonna find it.
Even if it takes
three.
You to bar, you know, you're
playing
on the two, three, the next
one. From the intro or just from the head?
Just take it right from the head, yeah.
All right.
What tempo you want?
A little faster than we do. One, two, three, four. Thank you.
Thank you. steps are wrong.
I like after the snow.
Everybody
was
doing this. Teach us the difference between mambo and rumba.
Okay. Mambo originally was played like this. One, two, three, five. Recordings, you're gonna hear the bell like that.
Yeah. Mambo?
Mambo.
Yeah.
It was played like that, Richard. And then originally it was very, very fast. It was so fast that when people dance mambo, they were like worn out.
Very downbeat oriented.
Yeah, so they slowed it down. And then mambo has that phrasing, you know, when you listen to the Dominican merengue, everything the horns are doing is mambo. I played with a Dominican orchestra in Miami, and I heard, when we go to the mambo bar, because they talk like that, when we go to the mambo bar, they stretch, and I said, wait a minute, the staff here says merengue, what do you mean mambo? And then the Dominican guy says, when we go to the bridge, you know, merengue always has maybe two chords at the most, you know. Merengue is nothing but a polka. The Dominican style, you know, they stylize it different, but it's a polka. So the bass used to play quarter, then this Kimon guy went to the Dominican Republic and he couldn't stand that, and he added a Kimon on the change of chord. So he started playing, simplify if you want to play that. So you don't break your head, you count it on four and you go 1, 2, and 3, 4, 1, 2, 1, 2, and 3, 4, 2, and 3, 4, 2, and 3, 4, 2, and 3, 4, 2, and 3, 4. Of course you're gonna be doing ding dong dong. Do that. Just counter it. You could do like a, try this. Ticket, 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 but try to make it with the tips. Like this. One example on the below rhythm. Ding 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 ding. That's mine, that's original. Ding 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 ding. When he does this, no, ding ding ding. Ding 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 ding. That's the rhythm, but it's not the notes that I'm singing.
Ah, okay.
Then the bass has to carry that. If you're doing my radio, ding 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 ding
Thank you.
danza music and contradanza. Contradanza is centuries old, and actually the Cubans brought it here a long way back when there was almost no music here, and they played it. And then that, what was the name of that French guy that used to play Cuban music that everybody called him Creole, but he was a Frenchman. See, what was the name? That Frenchman that used to play Cuban music. Yeah, they call him a Creole.
What instrument did he play?
That's the instrument I can't remember. I don't know if he played piano, but he fell in love with the Cuban music and the syncopation. He started playing it all over Louisiana, and they thought he was a Creole.
Mark Sanderson.
And in those days, the music in Louisiana was very primitive. They didn't have instruments like the symphonic. The Cuban brought that stuff here. Contradanza, it was fast.
You're not talking about Luis Gancho.
You're talking about from 1800s. Louis Maurice Gancho. What instrument
he
played?
The
first
one
to use.
Yeah.
He was a Frenchman,
right? Well, he's Creole French. He was born,
Creole is the son of a Frenchman or a Spaniard.
Right. The first one to use African instruments in orchestra.
Well, he was playing, Cuban music and Cuban.
Yeah, he was very influenced by.
Yeah, and the contradanza, the people here, they started to listen, but they couldn't transcribe it, and in those days they didn't read music, and they couldn't. So what they developed from that was the second line music, but second line music starts getting syncopated, and then it goes to the downbeat.
Right.
It doesn't go from contradanza. You don't go ding dong 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 ding dong. Keep going like that. Okay. Very, very ding dong, that's the cha-cha-cha. And cha-cha-cha is slow. But it's ding dong, ding dong, ding, and then you switch from ding dong, 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 ding dong. You switch, you always switch.
But Hector, we should wrap things up because I need to go.
Oh, okay. I'm fired?
You're fired. So, put a hand for Hector Gallardo.
When you play the tumbadoras, you see the two knuckles right here, you bring them in about this far in, about right here, until you get the bell hand the jury. To get that sound. To do what is called tapao, it's not a slap, you don't slap any Cuban drum. When you play the tapao, this knuckle has to come in this far in here like this, and it's just for linen, and then you produce the sound with the first bend of the finger. This finger here produces most of the sound on this one. Now, in theory, it's very simple, it sounds easy, but it's like getting an aperture on the trumpet. Watch it, listen to this. Now, when I do this, and I muffle it, or if I do this, that much in, you lean, and then you, and it doesn't matter if you lift this finger, it keeps your high pitch. Like I like to do it like this, for example, this phrase. It's a little bit, like a double stroke here and a stroke here, and the tumbadora drum, you do this.
Okay. 69.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's
lucky number.